All right, so we've been talking about who needs God, and last week we looked at a Bible tells me so Jesus, and it did rankle some feathers as I thought it would. And so one of the things we were talking about that last week is that one of the most important things was that something happened. There was a historic event that happened, and they documented it. All right, and that's where we basically got our New Testament. But the thing that really launched Christianity was that there was an event that happened at a point in history that completely changed the trajectory of the human race. And that was the resurrection of Jesus. And so even Jesus, when the Jews were talking to him about the importance of their scriptures and how intense they were about studying those scriptures, Jesus said, hey, you guys study the scriptures thinking that in the scriptures you're going to find life, but it's the scriptures that point to me. And so he is the fulfillment of all the scriptures. And life isn't in the scriptures per se, it's in the person of Jesus Christ because he is God in the flesh. And so when Jesus started his ministry, a bunch of followers started following him, and then he got crucified, and then nobody was following him, and then he was raised from the dead, then they started following him again, and then they started really getting it. And then all of a sudden, the Old Testament Jewish scriptures started making a whole lot of sense. Because they were looking through the scriptures now through the lens of the fulfillment of Jesus Christ. And you remember the story in Luke chapter 24. There's a couple of guys after the crucifixion, after the resurrection, and they're on their way to a town by the name of Emmaus, and Jesus comes among them, and they don't recognize him, and they're talking. And he goes, what are you guys talking about? And they look at him, and they say, like, are you the only person on the planet that doesn't know what just happened? Are you the only one in all of Jerusalem that you really don't know what happened? And Jesus goes, what things? Which is hilarious, isn't it? Because, I mean, like, he was literally the one that all those things just happened to. And he's like, what? And so they start saying, you know, Jesus of Nazareth, blah, blah, blah. And then it says, he took the scriptures and from Moses and through all the prophets showed them how the Christ must come and must suffer and be glorified and open up heaven's doors. And so they really got it. And then the Gentiles, as the Gentiles started coming into this faith in Christ because he's the Lord of life, he's the Lord of resurrection, they started getting excited about the Jewish scriptures also because they were like, we want to know more about Jesus and we're going to find out more about Jesus by going back into the Old Testament. And so they started studying. And, you know, a great scripture is Isaiah 53. Go home tonight and read Isaiah 53 and just ask yourself the question, who does that sound like? I mean, who is that guy talking? Who's Isaiah talking about? You know, it's so clear now after the facts, looking back through history, we say, boy, that sure sounds an awful lot like Jesus, right? And so Isaiah 53 is a great place to start with. And it was written, you know, 700 years BC, and yet it talks exactly about Jesus. So the Gentiles started getting really excited about the Jewish scriptures. And so they took them and combined them with all of these letters that were in circulation throughout all of the churches. And they put them together around the year 380 AD. And they came up with the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And so the Jews were kind of offended by that because they were like, what do you mean the Old Covenant? It's not the Old Covenant to us. It's very pertinent to us. Those scriptures are everything to us. And so, but Jesus started a new covenant, and we get that, we know that. Then around the year 130 AD, Merlito from Sardis was the first one to actually label the Old Testament the New Testament and put the Bible together, and then we have the Bible as we know it, where we have the Old Testament, the Jewish scriptures, and then the New Testament, what happened with the coming of Christ, and then, of course, his crucifixion, and then letters that the Apostle Paul wrote to churches and different things like that. And so we have a Christian Bible. But Christianity is really where we get the Bible from. It's not the other way around. We don't necessarily get Christianity from the Bible. We get the Bible from Christianity. And so one of the things we're doing is we're trying to encourage people that if you've walked away from faith because of a misunderstanding of the Bible or whatever it might be, maybe you walked away prematurely. Maybe you need to give it another look. Now, Andy Stanley, who's the one that put this series together, Who Needs God, you need to understand that he is all about reaching a millennial generation. He is all about reaching that large portion of our demographics in our country right now that are walking away from faith, walking away from religion, walking away from church, And so he's the one that is, you know, put this the way it is to say, hey, wait a minute. If you're wigged out about the Bible, don't worry about it. Why don't you start with the person of Jesus and then work backwards? Because they're walking away from maybe church doctrine and they heard crazy things or legalism or whatever it might have been. And so he's trying to rope them back in and say, listen, it's okay. Start with the person of Jesus. Now, one of the reasons that we take the Old Testament seriously is because Jesus took it seriously. And so, you know, we don't do away. Jesus didn't say, I didn't come to do away with the scriptures. I came to fulfill them. And there's a big difference there. So when somebody predicts their own death and then their own resurrection and then dies and then is raised, you know, you got to go with that, right? Because nobody else has done that in history. And so you got to go with that and you have to look at what Jesus says. And so I want to see the Old Testament the way Jesus sees the Old Testament. And one of the things that Jesus did is Jesus validated the Old Testament. Everything, you know, people have trouble with Jonah and the fish. And Jesus validated. He said, as Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days, so will the Son of Man be dead for 3 days. And then, you know, Lot's wife turning into a pillar of salt. And yet Jesus said, remember Lot's wife. So Jesus, you know, validated all of the Old Testament as he went through. So what we want to let people know is that, listen, even if you've never opened the Old Testament, even if you've never really even read the Bible, that's okay because Christianity starts with the person of Jesus first. That's what it's about first before you get into the Bible. Now, should we get into the Bible? Is the Bible important? Oh, yeah, absolutely. Because it's in the scriptures, especially the Jewish scriptures, that we see where the coming of Jesus was prophesied over 300 times. Very specific, that he would be born of a virgin, that he'd be born in Bethlehem, that he would flee to Egypt, that all these scriptures, that, you know, so it wasn't like something just happened. There was something that was prophesied. And that prophetic element is one of the ways that we know that the Bible is of God, because nobody could have done that. And very, very hard. As a matter of fact, when you look at the odds, it's something like 1 in 10 with like 43 pages of zeros after it, that one person could fulfill 300 scriptures perfectly the way Jesus did. One of the other things that absolutely blows me away is in the book of Daniel. So Daniel is an Old Testament prophet. And in the book of Daniel, Daniel's talking about a lot of things. He sees things from God. He's writing them down. And one of the things he said was this. He said, from the decree that goes forth to rebuild the Jewish temple, which happened in about 500 BC, till the destruction of that temple in the times of the Gentiles, which happened in 70 AD with the destruction of the temple by the Roman general Titus, he said, in that time is when Messiah is coming. So from 500 BC to 70 AD, who came that fulfilled those scriptures and that was the Jewish Messiah, you know, other than Jesus? There's absolutely no one. And if Jesus isn't the one, then there's never going to be a one because we've already passed the time of that prophecy. He said it's going to happen before the temple's destroyed in 70 AD. So we know that Messiah was going to come before that time. The only one that fits the bill, actually 100%, is Jesus. And so the scriptures are very important in pointing us to the person of Jesus. But one of the things we want to understand is that people follow Jesus after the resurrection because of the resurrection. All right, it was all about the event that took place in history and the overwhelming evidence that backed that and that supported that. And, you know, I don't know if you know this or not, but the resurrection of Jesus wasn't seriously debated for almost 100 years. Because the evidence was overwhelming. Remember, the eyewitnesses were there. And they testified and they documented and it was all there. And then they even gave their lives. How could you get a group of 120 plus people willingly sacrifice their lives for a lie? You know, that would never, ever happen in a million years. And so, so Christianity didn't begin with people believing something. It began with people seeing something. They saw something, they experienced something, they documented it, and it was the person of Jesus Christ coming back from the dead. And I don't know about you, but for me, that's really kind of true also. I mean, you know, I was brought up in Catholic church and went to eight years of parochial school. And so I had all that foundation to a degree, but I left all that. It didn't mean anything to me, okay? And then I got into a life of craziness and partying and addictions and blah, blah, blah. But then when I encountered Jesus, when I had an experience, just like they did, they saw something, they experienced it, I experienced something. Christ changed my life. Then I went back and started looking at the scriptures, and it was life. I mean, it was like, just can't devour enough of it. I don't know if you know, you had the experience that I did, but I remember before I accepted Jesus, I actually picked up the family Bible that was, you know, blow the dust off of it, because none of us read the Bible, and I thought, I'm going to read this. And I think I opened it to the book of Romans, because all I know, there were a lot of words that I didn't even understand, like justification and sanctification and purification and all of these, and it could have been written in the original Greek, and I wouldn't have not understood it any better, right? I mean, it was like, I didn't understand a word it was saying. I read like maybe a chapter and a half, and I'm like, what in the world is this, you know? I just put it away. It meant nothing to me. Then after Jesus came into my heart, the author came into my heart, now all of a sudden things made a lot of sense. Things really looked really, really good. So here's where we want to go with this today, is that Christianity is not a fragile thing. It's not like if all of a sudden somebody said, this is a lie and I can prove it, that we're all going to like cash in on Jesus. Because it's not necessarily about this, it's about Jesus. And that's a historical fact. So it's not a fragile thing. It's solid, it's sound, because it's his church, and he's infusing it with his life. But here's the thing. If Jesus is trustworthy, and he is, if Jesus could prophesy his own death, and he didn't do it by suicide, and if he could do, and if he could prophesy his own resurrection, which he did, and it all came about, then he is 100% trustworthy. Okay, and if Jesus is trustworthy, then what Jesus says about God can be trusted. Does that make sense? If Jesus is trustworthy, and he is, then what he says about God, it can be trusted. And so you want to know this to minister and reach out to a younger generation, especially a millennial generation that's adrift without any kind of religious background in their lives. So if your mind is even just a little bit open to try to understand who God is, then the best place to start knowing God is in the person of Jesus. What does Jesus say about God? So one of his followers by the name of John, you know, documented a lot of things. He was imprisoned on the prison island of Patmos by Demetrius and things like that. And so John records this interesting conversation in chapter 14. And this is how it goes. Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and he says, if you had known me, if you really knew me, then you would have known my Father also. Now, I mean, when you let that sink in for a minute, that's like profound. If you knew me, you would have known God. From now on, you know him and you've seen him. Now think about this. You've been following Jesus for 3 years, and Jesus lays this out on you. Well, guys, like if you really knew me, you'd know the Father. And from now on, you've seen the Father and you know the Father. And they're like, what, you know, what in the world are you talking about? And so Philip kind of expresses it in words. Philip says to him, Lord, show us the Father and it's enough for us. You know, we just want to know God. And could you do that? You know, could you just show us? We just want to know what God is really like. And so Jesus starts going into this, and this is what he says. Jesus said to him, have I been so long with you and yet you have not come to know me? Look where he's starting from. He says, Philip, don't you know me? Really? Don't you know me? And then he says this, he who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? And I can just see the disciples saying, oh, don't say that. I mean, don't say that, Jesus. You're totally messing us up here. For one thing, that's blasphemy. I mean, you got to understand that God, the most supreme, high being, the almighty, the all-knowing, the all-powerful, the creator of everything, God, his name was so holy that the scribes would wash their body completely before they would rewrite the name Yahweh or Jehovah in the scriptures. I mean, that's how holy and transcendent God was to them. And here's Jesus in front of them saying, dude, you see me, you see God. And they're like, you know, oh man, don't say that, Jesus. You know, that's hard to swallow. That's tough to take. And so then he goes on and he says this. Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? I'm in the Father, the Father's in me. Now, you got to understand something, okay? It would be easier for you and I to try to communicate to an ant than it is for God to try to communicate to a fallen human being that's in sin what he's like. I mean, how are they going to understand the concept of a Trinity? That there's one God in three persons, and they're of the same essence, the same substance, the same nature, true God of true God, true light of true light, one God, three persons. They don't even understand that. So Jesus is like, well, you know, if you see me because I'm in him and he's in me. You know, there's one God. And they're not getting this. They're not getting this at all, any more probably than we get it. And so he goes on and he says, the words that I say to you, I do not speak of my own initiative, but the Father abiding in me, he does the works. And so Jesus says two things here. He says the words and the works. The words and the works. So what he's saying is this. You want to know what God says? If you want to know what God says, listen to me. You want to know what God is up to? If you want to know what God's up to, then all you have to do is watch me. He's saying, you gotta watch what's going on. And then he says this, he goes on in John 14, and he says this, believe me that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me. Otherwise, believe of the works themselves. Jesus is saying, listen, if you're having a hard time understanding, then look at the works. Look what's going on. You remember in John chapter 3, Nicodemus is a ruler of the Jews. He's actually part of the Sanhedrin, which would have been like the Supreme Court of Israel. And he comes to Jesus at night because he's afraid to have that connection made with Jesus, in public. And he comes to Jesus at night and he says, teacher, we, the Sanhedrin, we know that you're from God because no one can do the works that you're doing if God's not with them. Now think about that. That's what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, listen, if you're having a hard time understanding that I'm in God, God's in me, that we're one, and I'm God in a bod and I'm revealing, then look at the works. You need to ask yourself the question. If God, any God, if whatever God might be out there, if God wanted to come to earth and manifest himself, what would he say or do that would be any different than what Jesus of Nazareth said and did? So let's just take a look at some of these works. Let's look at some of the signs that Jesus did. So Jesus demonstrates deity by performing signs showing that he has authority over nature. Nature runs by laws and runs by rules, and Jesus suspends those when he turns water into wine. Okay, that was his first miracle. He changed that. Jesus walks on water. All right, that doesn't happen every day. Jesus multiplies food in bread. It just starts multiplying in a basket. So he's showing that he has power over nature to suspend the laws of nature, to change the laws of nature. And we call these miracles. They're signs. They're wonder. Then he shows that he has authority over sin. You remember the guy that they cut a hole in the roof and they let him down? He was a paraplegic, and they let him down, and Jesus looks at him and he goes, your sins are forgiven. And everybody in the room, all the religious people are starting murmuring, like, who does he think he is? Only God can forgive sin. Now, they got that part right. Only God can forgive sin. And they're saying, so Jesus, to demonstrate, because how can you tangibly see the forgiveness of sin? You can't. There's no metric for that. You can't measure that. So Jesus says, in order for you to grasp the reality that I do have the ability to forgive sin, dude, get up and go home. And bam, the guy gets up off his pallet. He's completely healed. And I don't think he walked home. I think he did the jig all the way home, right? I mean, like, he's like, woohoo, cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. You know, he said, so they're now looking at this and saying, okay, that ain't normal. So if he did that, then he must be able to do the other stuff that he just said, which was forgive sin. So Jesus shows not only does he have power over nature, he has power over sin, and then he demonstrates through his works that he had power over the realms of the demonic, which they were greatly fearful of. And Jesus goes around and he's casting out devils everywhere he goes. He casts out devils. And a lot of times, even the devils spoke through the people that they had possessed, and they said, we know who you are, Jesus, the Son of God. We know who you are, the Most Holy One, right? And he was like, shh, not time for that to come out. That's not supposed to come out until I might make triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Which, by the way, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, fulfilled to the day another prophecy by Daniel. So everything, when we look at the scriptures, man, I want you to know everything to the minute, to the hour, to the day, everything is like bam, 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 bam. It's just that we don't understand it because we really don't study the scriptures the way we should. So Jesus shows that he's got power over the demonic. Then Jesus shows that he has power over tradition or the law because he said things like this. You've heard it say in the law, but I say to you, and he supersedes the law. He changes the law. He adds to the law. Right? You know, the law says if you know, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you, if somebody smacks you on the cheek, turn the other cheek also. I like the eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth side myself, quite frankly, you know, but Jesus, he changes the law, right? And so he shows that he has tradition, authority even over the Jewish tradition. And then, you know, the Feast of Erysus, Jesus shows that he has authority over death. Little girl, I say to you, arise. Whew. Lazarus, come forth. Now, I don't know about you, man, but that would have blown my mind. That would have blown my mind. Dr. Cho in South Korea, had a resurrection in his ministry, and all of his deacons ran out of the room. There was a room full of people, a room full of his church leaders. And he prayed for a guy and commanded him to come back to life. The guy came back to life, and all his deacons ran out of the room. Because, dude, there's a dead guy, and then he opens his eyes and starts breathing. Right? Like, is this the walking dead or what? I mean, you know, Jesus shows that he has power over life and death. And if he has power over life and death, then he has power over sin and the grave and even hell, that it cannot hold people. And so all of these things are happening, and Jesus is saying, listen, look at the works. Nothing has ever been done like this on planet Earth. So here it is. If we ask Jesus, what's God like? What's God like? First of all, first thing we have to do is get rid of all of our concepts. Get rid of all of our bad teaching. Get rid of all of our erroneous ideas. Remember, we talked about the somebody told me God, that a lot of people are walking away from a somebody told me God because that God never even exists in the first place. So we go to Jesus and we say, I don't want a somebody told me God. I want a you told me God. I want you to tell me who God is really like. So it's almost like we have to reboot the system. Sometimes your computer gets in a glitch and everything. You just have to either, you know, restart it or shut it off and start it so that it reboots itself. So we need to reboot our understanding of God. And this is what Jesus begins to teach us about God. Number one is that God is spirit. God is spirit. He didn't say God is a spirit, like he's Casper the Friendly Ghost or something. He said God is spirit. And this is what he said to the woman at the well in John chapter 4. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. So what does it mean that God is spirit? It means that God is immaterial. It means that God is spaceless and God is timeless. That's why God forbids, and even one of the big Ten Commandments is, you shall not make an idol. Because how is an idol going to convey the image of a God who is spirit? It can't be done. It can't be done. And so God is spirit. Now, this is exactly what most modern people would expect from God. Because scientists are always teaching that everything began with a singularity. That there was a singularity, and out of that event, everything came into being. They would call it the Big Bang or something like that. So all time, all space, all matter, all motion came from a singularity. Well, that's what Christians have always believed. That's what Jews have always believed, because that's what the scriptures teach us, that there is an uncreated creator. The first cause. And he's beyond the laws of nature. He created the entire physical universe and set it up that it governs itself by laws, but he himself are not bound by those laws because he is transcendent from his own creation. He's not part of creation. He's transcendent from that, and yet he's intimate with creation. He's not so far removed that he's unloving or he's uncaring. He's immanent. And so Jesus says to them, God is spirit. Well, you know, again, man, how do you grasp that? Because all of a sudden we can be thinking like, well, maybe God's like the force, you know, Luke, tap into the force. But no, he's personal. He's not just a force, he's personal. He knows the hairs on your head. He knows when a little bird falls out of the sky. He knows the thoughts in your mind before they're actually formed into words on your tongue. He's extremely intimate with you in your life. It's not the chi and the chang, and there's these, you know, forces out there in the universe, and, you know, this reiki healing where they're going to take the force of the energy of your body and heal some. You know, that's craziness. That's all occultic stuff. God is spirit. And he doesn't use reiki when he heals. He doesn't need any force of your body to heal. He's got enough force of his own. Believe me, he's got enough power of his own. He doesn't need any help from you. And so he's all powerful, and yet he's not corrupted by his own power. Now listen, that old saying, power corrupts, therefore absolute power corrupts absolutely. Right? And we see that. We've watched good men and women of integrity and honesty go to Washington, D.C., and within years they're corrupted. Yet God is all powerful, yet he's not even corrupted by his own power. So we say, okay, well, God is spirit, and I understand that he's intangible, he's immaterial, he's personal, he's not bound by space, he's not bound by time, he's spirit. But I need something more than that, Jesus. I need a little bit more to go on. And Jesus says, God is Father. Wow. Not the reflection of earthly fathers. Because some people hear this and it would immediately distress them because they didn't have a good father. So one day Jesus is praying, and Jesus obviously had a connection with the Father that was observable, because the disciples came to him and they said, teach us to pray like that. And so in Luke chapter 11, Jesus said this, when you pray, say, Father. Father who is in heaven. Father. In order to understand the relational aspect with God, this is the starting place. God is like a father. Not that God is masculine or feminine. God transcends gender. He created us sexual beings. And isn't that the root of a lot of confusion and a lot of sin that we have nowadays? But God transcends that. He's spirit, and yet he's personal. And the best way to grasp that relationship with God is, he's my father. And not only is he my father, because sometimes that can be a real authoritative thing, depending on what kind of household you grew up in. But the Bible actually says that he is Abba, Father, which in the Greek means daddy. He's daddy. Now, imagine in your mind what would be the most awesome dad in the world, and then times it by like a billion, and that would have been God, a perfect father. So always accepting, always approving, always loving, always encouraging, yes, maybe correcting, but the love that God has as a father is the best picture that we can understand the relationship that we have with God. So Jesus said, listen, God is spirit, God is father. Now, what is the crisis of our generation today? Fatherlessness. Fatherlessness. Listen, when I was in school not that long ago, I was looking at my eighth grade picture the other day, and it was amazing. No, so, you know what? All the kids in my school had a home, had a family, had a mom and a dad. That was their mom and dad. Today, even right here in the Raymond School District, almost 50 to 60% of the kids don't have a biological mom and dad in their home. Because the family's broken up and there's so much divorce and remarriage and stepdads and stepmoms and all this kind of stuff. And so we don't even have that aspect of the home. 100% of every inmate in death row today has one thing in common. They didn't have a dad. So what is the importance of fatherhood? It's massive. It's beyond measure. It's huge. Kids need a dad that will be involved in their lives and that will love them and that will teach them and embrace them and hug them and launch them off into life. Kids need a dad. So after Jesus ascends. John writes another concept. God is Spirit. God is Father. And then he says, God is love. Now, John is a Jewish disciple. He grows up as a Jew. The Jews understood that God loved them and basically tolerated everybody else. So for John to write this to the world that, hey, you know what? It's not just the Jew, but God loves everybody, because the Jews wouldn't even hang out with Gentiles, because to hang out with them would have made them unceremonial clean. How would you like to have a friend that couldn't hang out to you, because if he did, he would look bad in the eyes of God? Now, I had kids that wouldn't hang out with me because it would make them look bad in the eyes of their moms. You know what I'm saying? Don't hang out with that kid down the road. He's bad news. So I had that kind of stuff. And it was the influence of my brothers was bad on me. It wasn't me. So remember Beelzebub and okay, never mind. So John says this in 1 John 4. He says, we've come to know and have believed the love God has for us. God is love. The one who abides in love and abides in God, and God abides in him. So Jesus is saying, listen, this is the distinguishing hallmark of a follower of me. They're going to love one another. By this, all men will know that you're my followers, that you're going to love. So if you don't display the love of God, you're not displaying the character of God, because it reflects his very nature. The nature of God is love. And so we need to get that. Remember the vision that Peter had? He sees a sheet come down, and there's all kinds of critters in there, and God says, arise, kill and eat. And Peter's looking there, and it's like there's pigs. And he goes, that food's unclean. I'm a Jewish boy. I'm kosher. I can't. And God says, eat it. If I say it's clean, it's clean. And he sees that three times. Then there's a knock on the door, and there's some guy saying, hey, we want you to come to a Gentile's house and preach the gospel. Now remember, Peter was given the keys to the kingdom. Peter is the one that unlocks the Jewish world on the day of Pentecost, and now he needs to unlock the Gentile world. And God is saying, I want you to go and unlock the Gentile world. And Peter's like, no, man, they're unclean. And Jesus is basically saying, shut up. If I'm saying they're clean, because I love everybody, not just one or a race. I love everybody. It's a reflection of the very nature of God. So God is Spirit, God is Father, and God is love. This is who Jesus begins to teach us who God is. And we say, well, how do we know that God is good? I mean, really, how do we know that God is a loving God? And this is a crazy answer. Shade requires the sun. You say, what in the world does that mean? Well, you can have sun without shade. Right? You go into the desert and you're just going to have sun. No shade. But you can't have shade without the sun. Does that make sense? Okay. You can't have evil without good. You can have good without evil, but you can't have evil without good, which shows us the pre-existing nature of God, that God is loving. So love must necessarily pre-exist unloved or evil. You can't have unlove first. You can't. And so this is why God cannot be evil. Now listen, the Romans, the Greeks, the pagans, they all had their gods, and all of their gods had evil traits inside of them. They were malicious. They were more like human beings, which makes sense because they were coming from the heart and the mind of humans that were creating these gods. But you can't recognize evil and injustice, or the reason you recognize evil and injustice is because you know the difference between good and justice. You can't recognize evil or injustice unless you first know that there's good and justice. And every time you make an appeal to what's right or what's just in the world, you are declaring the very essence and existence of God. Every time. When a person seeks shade, they're declaring the existence of the sun. Automatically. Every time we seek righteousness, goodness, fairness, equity, justice, we're declaring the existence of God. And every time you think or imagine that God is a loving God, that is distinctively a Hebraic, Jewish, and Christian mindset. Because it doesn't come from any of the other gods. The gods of Egypt, the gods of Greek, the gods of Rome, the gods of the barbarians and pagans, none of them had that characteristic and quality that they were loved. And it didn't say that God was loving. It said that God was love. I mentioned that book a lot of times, Imagine Heaven, which that guy documented a lot of people who died and he interviewed them and everything like that. One of the things they said that absolutely blows me away is that when they finally died and got into the spiritual realm, the spiritual existence, and began to see, you know, paradise and see things and usually a bright light, they said that that light was also overwhelming, unimaginable love. Like you just couldn't, they just say, they can't even put it into words. They say can't even describe the feeling of love because I've never even felt it like that. So God is love. Now this prompts the question, if God is love, why is there evil in the world? And we're going to look at this next week, but let me answer this question by asking another question, and that is, why do you know that there's evil in the world? How do you know? How do you even know what's evil or what's not evil? I mean, we would watch a nature show and we would see a pack of 15 or 20 wolves going after a poor little elk that got separated from the flock, and then it's just they jump on it and they hamstring it, they pull it, and we would say, "Oh, that's evil. That's disgusting." The wolves wouldn't think that. They don't look at themselves as evil. They look at themselves as hungry. So nature doesn't have that. You're not going to find this in nature. People say, well, I go to nature. That's where I experience God. Maybe a little bit. You might see his grandeur and his creation, but you don't get it all. You certainly don't get the idea of a moral, loving father through just nature itself, right? So how do we know that the world around us is broken? How do we know that we're broken? Why is it people feel guilty? And why is it that people sometimes love their worldly friends better because they can party with them and their friends aren't uptight about all this religious stuff? Well, it's because there's a sun. And they're seeking shelter of the shade. In other words, there's accountability with a relationship with God, and people don't want to be accountable. And so they come up with the excuse that, well, nobody's perfect, which begs another question. How do you know what perfect is? Where do you get a concept of perfect? Where did that come from? John would answer that question by saying, perfect love precedes us. The singularity, the beginning was love. And therefore we have a perspective. So, you know, where do we get our ethics, our morality, our justice, our goodness? Where do we understand these things? God is love. So, let's just review really quick. God, Jesus, who's God? Well, God is Spirit, God is Father, God is love. Now, here's a homework assignment that I want all of you to do. It's not going to be long, trust me, okay? I want you to read the Gospel of John. It's like 15 pages. Okay, it's not long. I want you to read the Gospel of John, and when you read it, I want you to ask yourself this question. What do I learn about the Father from the Son? Read the Gospel of John and just say, okay, if God is in Jesus and Jesus is in God, I'm going to look at Jesus, and what is Jesus showing me about the Father as I read this short little book of John? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness in our lives. We thank you that you love us, that you call people out of darkness into your light, into your love. And Lord, we just want to know you better. We want to know you more. We want to grow in the knowledge of God. And Father, we also want other people to know. So the more we know, the better equipped we are to reach them and show them what God is like. So Lord, maybe some of this message is for our benefit. Maybe it's just for our instruction so that we can be a blessing to others, especially a younger generation that just never was shown or never got it about who God is and what God is like. And this helps us answer the question, who needs God? Ultimately, everybody does. And so, Lord, use us as your vessels, as your tools, as your ambassadors to reach out with the love of God. to a broken and confused generation. We thank you for all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Hey, greet somebody as you're leaving again. There's goodies out in the fellowship hall. Have some coffee, have some good things.